That's fine. Mute your speakers. I think it's good. It's fine.
Okay, I'll stand.
Okay.
So, hello. Good morning. I am Anisha Mishra. I'm a software engineer at Cisco. So, as a starter for this meetup, we'll be talking about an easy topic about Go, that is Go templates. So, is there anyone in here who have already worked with Go templates or at least encountered with certain code? Your experience, please.
So basically, I worked on Kubernetes resources.
Okay.
What we're doing on Microsoft, we use resources. Deploying new secrets.
So
all of them are templated in JSON format.
Okay.
So basically, Kubernetes, the resources are in YAML. We convert them to JSON and we templatize whatever the fields that can be.
Okay.
So we deploy, we apply them on. Okay.
So did you find it easy?
Yeah,
it's very easy, right? What about you? So
4 years ago, I started with this Go templates.
Okay.
And I didn't like it too much, so I switched to backend.
Okay, I'll ask this question again. Whether you, like, what's your opinion about Go templates now? Okay. So, anyone else? Yeah.
I used to make Helm actually.
Yeah, Helm also uses Go templates.
But I think you can three networks in the future. You can three for team, I'm not sure. But you can do it using.
There are some additional features also that are added to the native Go templates that has been used in Helm. So they have their own features also in addition to what Go template has to provide. So it's a very powerful method using which you can format your output. We have all used templates or merging data in at least MS Word, right? So the same concept is applied here also. When you want to merge two data sources to get a formatted output, you'll be using Go templates. And it's, believe me, it's very simple, okay? You don't need any third-party libraries. Go comes with inbuilt template engine. There are two packages using which you can leverage the features that Go has to provide. Those are text template and HTML template. Both of these are pretty much similar, but when you are using templates to generate HTML pages for websites, so it is recommended that you use HTML template package because it protects the pages from any XSS code injections and all the, mainly that part, where you can just hack the page through inputs. So that part is eliminated. That is why it is recommended to use HTML. Otherwise, for all other purposes, you can use text template. Suppose you want a formatted output in your terminal or say in a file. You want to generate 1,000 files which have a similar kind of template. You can use the first package for that. Okay. So next we'll see how a simple template looks like. Here, we can pretty much assume that the output will definitely have this clause my name is, and this dot name looks like a variable, okay, and my age is this. So this is kind of a format that I am giving to a program, and later on I will provide the value of name and age. Focus on these double curly braces, okay? Any logic that you want to input to a Go template, that should be enclosed with double curly braces. By logic, I mean if-else statements. You want to create new variables in a template or use a for loop inside a template, or say you want to pass a function that a particular template does not support. We'll come to all these examples later on. Okay. First, First, we'll see how we can use if-else statement in the template. If-else is mainly about comparisons, right? We use double equal to sign or exclamation and equal to. Unfortunately, templates do not support these. Instead of these symbols, we'll be using keywords. See the first one, double equals to, which means equals. Pick up the first two letters, you'll get EQ. To compare the two arguments, you will have to use the keyword EQ when you want to equate two things in a template. Okay. After this, I'll show you the examples, like how we can use this. Similarly for greater than, equal to, less than, equal to, you don't have to remember this. I'll tell you what. Say less than, equal to. There are three words, less than, equal to. Pick up the first letters of the important words, that is less and equal to, L-E. The equivalent keyword is L-E. Similarly for less than, two words, L-T. The corresponding keyword will be L-T. Okay. So these are for the comparison part. Next, I'll show you an example. If LT means less than requires two arguments. First one will be argument one, that is dot age, and 18 will be the second argument. So finally, the logic will be if age is less than 18, output will be I am not eligible to vote. Got it? Then else. You can have else if also. How you can do this is, after else, leave a space, write your if condition again. You can also implement nested if else conditions in a template. And one thing that is very important, the if else block should end with this end, last part that you see. Double curly braces and end. This is very important, okay? Otherwise, your template parsing will fail. You can have nested if else statements, else if, all combinations that you use in your normal coding. You can do all of those here also. Anything you want to discuss about if else? Okay. Next, how you can declare variables. Fortunately, this part is very similar to the way you do in Go. In Go, we declare variables with colon and equal. Okay. Here also, we will be using the same syntax. Now, how will you distinguish between the variables that you have given to the template and the variables that you have declared and initialized in a template? The distinction can be done using the dollar sign. The variables that you create inside a template should begin with the dollar sign. Okay. And the time when you're declaring, you also have to initialize it. You can't just declare and leave the variable. Okay. So initializing will be colon equal to the value that you want. If you want to reassign the value to a particular variable, you don't need to give the equal. Look at the last line. Age equals to 99. Because I've already declared the variable. Okay. So this is the way you can distinguish between the variables that you create in a template and the variables that you are actually passing to the template.
Can you just share the screen? Go to Zoom. There is Zoom. Just stop this.
Best of one only.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, let's talk on this one.
Fine, right? So in templates, well, now we are done with if else conditions and variables. Next important thing in any coding language, for loop. Okay. So we don't have anything like for in Go templates. Instead of that, we have range. Okay. There are two ways of writing range in a template. First one is range dot. It will be more clear when I show you an example. Dot is something like a pipeline, and what a pipeline might be, an iterable data structure. Okay, so for now assume that the dot is say an array. Okay, now dot would be the name that I give to one element of that array, like you use for I in range 1 to 10. So I is a variable that will be representing each element of that list or array. Here dot will be representing each of that item in the particular list. Now if you don't want to use dot, you can give a variable name to it. Say person. So in the for loop, you will be referring to each item as dollar or person dot any of its say property. Suppose I have a struct name person, name and age. I'm passing it to range. So I can either write dot name and use the value, or I can use dollar person dot name and use the value. I'm sorry if I'm not able to explain it properly, but once I show you the code, you'll be able to understand it in more precise way. Okay. So this is how we have for loops also. See here. The thing that I mentioned earlier, range dot, I can simply do my name is the variable. So I have a list of I have an array of structs where each struct has a property name. So if you go and run this loop and write multiple statements, say my name is this, my name is this, my name is this. Okay. Or I can use dollar person and I can write this way. Okay. So templates are mostly about these things. Now you can break templates as well. Like I have a particular section, I name it template 1. Now I can reuse this template in other templates. I suppose I have a template 2, there I have to call template 1 3 times. I can do that. How I can do is, first template that you want to call multiple times, you use the define keyword and give it a name. Okay, double quotes is missing here. It should be there. So I give the template a name, use the end block there, and later on I can call this template multiple times using the keyword template. Okay. So nested template is here. Next, we talked about templates a lot. Now how to use them? There are mainly three functions that we will be using from the text template package. First one is new. New function will create an undefined template, no memory allocated, just a template object pointing to null. Now, if I want to parse a template string, all those examples that I showed earlier would be actually a string. You need to parse it to create a template object. How to parse it? You will be using the parse function. Once I have parsed it, I have a template object. Now I need to pass data to it and tell him where to write it. So that part is done using execute function. So these are the main functions. Apart from this, there are many variations of these. Like parse will be parsing a string. But there is another function called parse files, where you are writing templates in a file and you want to parse them all in one go. If you want to do that, you'll be using parse files. Suppose you have multiple files and you want to use few of them, not all. You'll be using parse glob, where you give a regex of the template file and only those template files will be parsed. Okay. So this was a basic about template. Next we'll be coding few templates. Okay. So this is our first code. Let's zoom in. Able to see it? This is the package of which we are talking about. Where S equals to a string, which is actually a template. And a variable dot name. Template dot new introduction. I created a plain template. This is the name that I'm giving to the template. Earlier we saw while we were using the define keyword, we have to give a name to the template so that we can reuse it later on. Similarly, here we are using this new function to give a name to the template. This is an empty object right now. Next sentence I'll do parse s. S is actually the string which contains the template. It will parse the string, check whether it's valid or not, store the result in t.error. If suppose I miss one of the braces here, it will throw an error, I'll get it here. If it is valid, I'll get the t object, otherwise it will be none. Next, I'll do t.execute. os.testvideoout is a terminal out. So what? And from where it will get this name, I'm giving a map. So what this execute function expects is a writer object and a data interface. Okay. This part actually is an interface. You can give anything. A struct, a map, an array, even empty string. It will work. While you give the output, it will show none at the place of name. Because I did not get the value of name. Okay. So here I am giving map where the key is name and correspondingly the value is there. Even if I turn this to small n, the template will not work properly. It will print my name is angle bracket something else. Any doubt in this code?
So let me change this name to say some random character and run this again. Oops, I did not save it, sorry. Okay, now I will change the n here. I'll make it small. And let's see what is the output now. No value. Okay. So this was,
we saw a template where we are directly putting it as a string. Next, we'll write template in a file, read it, give it out some input to it and see what is the output.
So earlier example, we used a map. In this, we'll be using a struct. First, I'll show you the template, how it looks.
Okay. Here, what I've tried to do is, I'm defining a template. I'll be reusing it later. Okay. Define introduction. Later on, I'm using it in the same way, template introduction. Okay. What is there in define? If age is less than 18, I am eligible to vote, else not. So if ended with end, define also ended with end. Okay. Those who have used Go templates earlier, can you tell me what does this mean? Dash.
No new line.
Sorry?
No new line.
Yes. Actually, it removes all white spaces. If I use this dash from here till the next word letter, it will remove all white spaces. Now I'm introducing you to someone, range, dot. Where this value for dot will come, we'll see it in the Go code. my name is dot name. Here you can figure out that I had a struct which had a property name. That is being used here. Template introduction. So inside this for loop, I'm calling this template multiple times. And range also ends with this end block.
Now, the go.
Here is a struct with the name person. N should be capital because whenever you want to export any value function or any of the object in Go, its name should start with capital N. So to make use of this struct in the template, you'll have to export this struct. And for exporting, you'll have to put this P capital, N capital, A capital. Okay? If I use this smaller, again we'll get no value. Because this part was not exported. Here, I'm creating an array of person which has two objects. Name Mohan, name Rohan, and corresponding age. Okay? Next, again I'm creating a new template. This time I'm using the function parse files because parse function will express only one argument, that is string. Here I have to give a file, so I'll be using parse files which expects an array of file. Okay, file name actually as string. So here I can put comma and give multiple template files also. So parsing is correct and you get the T output. Execute os.stdout output. Terminal output and the input that I'm giving is A, which is array of person. This is the variable that is later referred in the template as dot. Okay. Got it? Because I'm giving only one input, which is put into a pipeline for the template. When the template is searching for value, it finds that it's A. So it assigns it to dot. Wherever you use dot in the template, A will be referred.
So this is the entire code. Now we will execute it.
Okay. Introducing you to someone. My name is Mohan. I am not eligible to vote because Mohan's age was 10. And my name is Rohan. I am eligible to vote. Rohan's age was 20.
In the template, we saw that we are using this if-else section
to compare the age of both Mohan and Rohan and decide whether they are eligible to vote or not.
Last one.
So, we saw if-else statements. We saw using templates inside our template. One more thing is there. Suppose I have a function that I have defined in a code like this, is prime. Now you want to use this function in my template, in one of the if-else or some value calculation part. How can I do this? For this, you will be needing a
function called func, F-U-N-C. Where you will be calling it? You will be calling it before parse files.
Okay, why we are passing it before parse files is your template will be calling those functions. So before I parse that template, the engine should know that, okay, this is a function. How it will know that this is a function? Before parsing, you'll have to give all the functions to the template. How we can do is this funcs function. What is TF here?
Wait.
The first part is the prime, the normal logic for finding whether a number is prime or not. We will see what is going on here. So TF is template.func name. What I this is kind is a map as indicated in the name. Here contains will be the key that I'll be using in the template. What function it will refer to? Strings.contains. This is a normal Go function. Next is prime. In the template, if I want to call this function, I'll use this. I can give any rubbish here, but I'll have to call isPrint with this rubbish here. Okay. So I defined a func name. Then again the same procedure. I'm creating a new template. Before parsing the file, I'm giving the functions, this template func name, parsing the files and executing it. Here, since I'm not giving any input, I've given an empty string. Okay. Even empty string will work. Because the second argument of execute will be interface. Anything can be interface. So, this is the code. Now, we'll see what is there in the template file. If not, okay, I can use not, I can use and, I can use or also. For comparison operators, we'll be using LE, EQ for equal to, LE for less than equal to, LT for less than G. Okay. These keywords will remain the same as normally, not and all. Okay. If not, isPrint 28. isPrint was the function. It was expecting one argument, that's a pure int type, I've given 28 as the argument. I don't need any round brackets, I'll simply put a space and give the arguments. So, I'll write 28 is not prime. Is prime? Huh, okay. Else if, is prime 67. I'm again calling the same function. I don't need to put any dot in front of this function. For variables, data structures and interfaces only, I'll be using dot, not for functions. If a statement ends with dot. If contains. Contains was referring to strings.contains function of Go. Olan, the first argument, that is the string. Go is the second argument, which should be the substring of strings.contain. How do you write strings.contain in normal Go? Strings contain, strings.contains. First argument will be string, whatever, Olan, comma, Go, which is the substring that you want to search in the first argument. Similarly, if you have used your contains, first argument, second argument, match power. Similarly, same way. Potluck, food. If food is there in potluck, it will print this. So this part, this thing will return false, okay? So in the output, this should not come. Let's execute this and see. So 28 is not print, match found. Potluck part was not printed because it the condition turned out to be false. Okay. So these are the major things about Go templates. If you have any questions for me, yes.
Both text templates and HTML.
Yes. Yes. So how do you start an HTML page? Top type HTML, HTML, head, body. You will be writing all those parts in the template file. Wherever you need data extra from external source, you will be using those curly braces. The same syntax, if else, range, using template inside template, all nested things, you can save it. Just that it prevents you from code injection, that is why it is asked you to use HTML template. That is when you are creating HTML files and JS files also.
Anything else?
It's called feature interactions.
Okay.
You can actually call the functions by giving the dot function name.
Okay. I am not aware of that part. So, when I was trying to pass out functions, so this is the method. I mainly went through the documentation of HTML text templates. So, it was mentioned that, okay, you can pass functions using func map. Call might be an option, but I did not encounter it anymore.
So, what are the most common?
I'll tell you my experience in that case, okay? So I'm working on developing a Terraform provider. You can assume it as a plugin using which you can maintain configurations of servers or a data center. Okay. So there, for each model, I should have two files. One is resource files, data source files. I'll not be explaining what are those. So those are some Terraform related terms. So for each MO building two files, so in a big application, there might be some 1,000 MOs. So writing 2,000 files is something that is not feasible. If something changes also in future, I'll be going back to that particular file and making changes. This is something that is not feasible. And if I have one resource file, one data source file, there are few things that remain the same. Few things change, that is the model name, the property, the type. So in this part, I can use templates. So yeah, I agree, it will be a complicated one. I'll have multiple templates for generation of one resource file, but then I can use that to generate thousands of them. Even if you add new MOs, say one day I wake up and add 50 models, I can rerun the model and get resource files, data source files for those, right? Anything more?
Like, have you actually gone through the Helm chart, which is also using a template?
Helm.
No, I thought like the provider or something, you can just show a sample.
Okay. I'll show you my code.
Sure.
Okay. So this is a Terraform provider that I have been working. Inside this intersite folder, there are only four files that are handwritten. Rest, everything is generated. I'll show you two files. So you'll understand that, yeah, these two files look similar and they can be generated using templates. So first one is, say, data source, okay? Look at these imports. There are seven imports fixed. There is this format, read. Schema is something that is specific to the MO, models, and I can generate these part also. Because these are some keywords that are fixed or depend on some conditions, so optional. So in a database, I have one of the fields that is optional, that's not required. Name is a required field. Age might not be a required field. So these are some conditions that I'll be putting into the template and then generating these files. So this is the file. Now imagine this is a 313 lines code and this is entirely generated. I'll show you one more file and you'll see that, yeah, the structure is pretty much similar. The next one, okay. Same imports, your, again, read, schema, the model properties, okay. So how this nested part, I've used range, inside range. So we have schema, after that we have a function which looks pretty much similar like the last one, and this one is 288 lines code. Okay, so the few things that are variables are actually variables in the template also, to which I'll be providing data, and these files will be generated. So you see here all data sources. After that, resources will also come. Okay, done. Then resources with the same name, resource. Earlier it was data source adapter config policy. Now it is resource adapter config policy. Again, same number of files. Okay, so all of these files are generated from five templates. Templates, okay, I'll show you. Okay, so let's pick parse property.
Okay. here I have given a map where, see, the one P is all models params. Another P is primitive data type formats. So I don't want to do anything with these values directly. So I'm saving them into a variable. Okay, so this is the variable declaration. Here are the, so what is this index? By accessing an item in an array, what do you do? You do index it. Say arr square brackets 1, 2, 3. So this thing you cannot make a change. So you'll be using the index keyword, which the package provides. So index, array name, and the array or any iterable data structure, and the index or key. So here, so schema type test is actually a map, and this is the key value. So I'm searching index, map, key value, its value is stored here. So yeah, rest of the things we have discussed, if else, and this is nested if else. So all those things we have discussed is in this file. Nothing extra is there, just that it's a bit too much nested. Okay, and here you can see I've used one and this particular template again, like in a recursive fashion. You see this template's name is parts property type.go.tmpl. Again, I'm calling this template inside that template only. Okay, so nested template can also be used. Yeah, and here you can see I've used and, not, any is not equal. Okay, so we have some normal if else conditions and complicated if else conditions. That is the only difference. And I'll show you all those files that I've showed you earlier, data sources and resources. Those were generated using these templates. So I put my effort in writing these templates. Those files. If you do any change in the models, I'll just rerun this and I'll get the corresponding resources. You can give anything. This is a convention. Yes.
You have some of the, like, how do you write tests in this case? Because if people make mistakes, then it becomes tricky.
Yeah. So, say in my case, I was using templates to generate Go files. Okay. At some point of time, my plugin will be implementing those Go files. So I can write templates for the test files also.
As in, what I meant is, do you have any tests to verify your template is working fine?
Like this template is working fine. Yeah, when I use the parse function, so it returns two results. That is the template object and the error. So at that point of time only, it will throw an error saying that this particular template is not up to the syntax. It can check only syntax. Okay. So yeah, there you can detect whether the template is fine or not. Otherwise, like I showed you, I made the n in name small. So that is an error that I cannot detect. Right. So the template worked fine. I executed the template also, but instead of getting the name, I got no value. So if I do the similar thing in the Go template files, I'll get no exported value. Okay.
But also, we have unit tests for the generated.
For that I can write templates. For generated files, since they are Go, they are not some plain formatted output. So I'll be writing templates for testing those.
Still trying to understand, like, what is needed here, like, because I see a lot of Go files are there. I'm assuming, okay, it's similar code, can't we write some reusable function? Like, what is the specific use case? I'm missing that part. Like, why, I understand, like, if you want to write a lot of things which is similar, you're writing a template and then making use of it.
Yes.
But I could have written a function which is doing the code's work, right? which can be reused.
And or how that function would look? Because see, in this template, it's not just logic, right? I have some plain text also, like package name. Okay. So these things, if even if you write a function, you'll be creating a string variable. The value would be package main. Then you will be concatenating strings. So instead of doing that, plus concatenation of multiple strings is not something that is recommended, right? So that is why we are using templates here. So these are few parts which will be printed as it is. These are not logics. So, and when I go to the logics part, they are like very much nested. Say I range, and inside if else, I have multiple if elses, and then end these parts. So when I want to do a very logic oriented formatted output, it is preferable that I do through templates. And since debugging also becomes easier, that you will have to scan only one file. In functions, what you will be doing is, you will be writing the same thing, but in Go format, right? If else, there will be also if else, instead of range, you will be using for loops and all. It will be the same thing. Okay. Yes. This part is something that I want to be printed as it is in output. Something that is not inside curly double curly braces will be printed as it is. Like common text, a string.
So the double parenthesis is like a ginger text. It will get replaced with that particular value.
Yes, exactly. So here double curly braces, okay. The engine will be active, okay. I have to do something here. What it is, it's a get string.
You will look for the reports and the functions.
Yes, exactly. So it will be like putting values into this double curly braces only. Apart from that, you see this section, this entire section, it will be printed as it is along with the white space. So if I want to remove white spaces, I'll be using dashes. And I have to leave a space between dash and E, otherwise the parsing will fail. Okay, so I can use dash this side also and this side also. So depending on my need, I'll be using here or on both sides. You can input comments also. That should also be inside double curly braces. And we'll be using hash. So double curly braces, hash. Kubernetes and Docker. So this is one of the components that Go provides, so that you don't have to do the same thing multiple times. That is why we use Go templates. I think there are templates in other languages also. You can use.
One thing you want to mention, I think this could be answer. So you were saying like in template, I could use only variable here and could use just the normal template dot. So dot is something, if something is not returnable.
What represents the see, I have a template and I have a Go code which is calling that template. In between, assume there is a file. I'm sending data. Okay, use this data in the template and generate the output. So this file is represented by dot. So if I send only one output, say in the earlier example I sent an array of structs. So that entire thing is represented as dot.
If I don't pick something from that, do it like simple stuff.
Ah.
So, How to pick that?
Okay, we'll do that. What happens?
So here I'm using range dot. Okay. So I'll remove this entire code. Okay. So what it will do, whatever is there in dot, it will print that. Correct? I'll run and see what happens. So this is go template 2.
I send the array as the input to the template. When I printed dot, it printed the entire thing. So if I want to use only one thing, I'll have to give the dot to a for loop. Like we did earlier. I'll show you the template again.
Thank you.
Thanks, Alex, for giving a talk. We can actually take a break now or finish the talk and we'll take a break and we basically have to. You guys want to take a break now? Or, you guys are all good, right? Talk is Okay. So, given that, the moment that people don't receive, hey, I'm not able to receive a payment for a particular driver, they complain, hey, is there something wrong with Kafka? But even though there is a lot of other things which is working fine, people suspect us because they don't understand things completely, because there could be something wrong in producer, there could be something wrong in consumer, or even though your database, something is failing, if you don't consume or if you have a wrong message, you can't proceed further. There is so many things which can go wrong in this particular ecosystem. And to debug it, it is really hard because, like as I said, we start with, hey, is there something wrong in producer? Is there a data coming in? Okay, fine, all good. Now let's go to the consumer one and then see whether there is data coming in. Good. Now database, is it all fine? Yes. Then go to consumer two, then check the last business ops, where exactly is the problem. So this is actually time consuming. And also for us, it's not like, as in segregating the responsibilities, it's not fair to say, hey, our responsibility is Kafka, but we are debugging everything, even though root cause could be something else. So eventually what we ended up doing was, okay, we will verify our Kafka system is working fine at all the time. I'll show you something. It's fine, I hope. I'll show you a smaller version first. So I thought initially how we started was, okay, now we have a Kafka cluster. What is the objective of Kafka cluster is you produce some messages and then you consume messages. If you produce 100 messages and if you're able to consume 100 messages, then the cluster is good, right? So that is what you can see here. So number of messages sent, number of messages lost, I mean, this is just a random report, and then received messages, and then how much time it took. So that even though you have some issues in latency is also critical, like I'll come to that part later. So this is the high level thing which we want to achieve, right? Like, can anybody quickly think like how you can do this? Like, anybody worked with Kafka before? Okay. So, I hope you got the context. If not, let me know, I can add more context. So, as I said, all we need to do is run producers, like produce n messages, and then run consumers. You can have multiple consumers and consume, and then track the messages. That's it. So, and then you see where the messages is actually being, whether the message is being lost or not. And you can actually compute the time between the message which is produced and then message, the point at which you consume. So there is a TP, when you produce, there is TC. So TC minus TP is actually the like lag or like latency between end to end. So we'll keep the latency as a second part, but the objective of this talk initially I thought was, we'll go into the library, we'll touch upon like how core components of Golang actually applies into it, writing any library. But I think since most of the people are beginners, I'll also show some sample code, like basic code, and then we'll talk about it. So if you are still like, let me know if you still want to know more about the context. We can look at the graphs and stuff at the end, probably run a demo also. So I think Go is mostly well known for multiple things people write it, but majorly one is backend services. The other part is writing command line tools. Like recently, I don't know whether you guys noticed FPP or any Git tool you use or any command line you would have seen, it was rewritten in Golang, now it's being rewritten in Rust and stuff like that. So, and this is a command line application, it's very easy to write. And then we have a lot of ops kind of things we do. We automate it in Golang. I can share context at that end. But the crux of any application is, let's say you have some logic to do, but you want to do something very generic, right? So let's, I know which one to pick. So let's see, I think Git is a good example, right? So Git has a lot of verbs or hey, Git, commit. And then that again has a lot of flags to pass. So all of this you see is actually a command line tool. Even what you see here, right? Like go test, this is again a command line tool, right? Internally it's all like Git, I'm not sure how it's written, but this go test or whatever tool you use as a go wet, it is
command line tool, which is actually written in Go itself. So this is the like command you're gonna run, and these are all the flags. So I think Go help test would be much better. So this is the flags, and these are the like operations which you can do on top of it. So that is the first part, right? Like what you're gonna do, you will define the business context. Then you need some tool to actually implement that. So the major thing which we use is Perfave CLI. We'll just look at this. So now you see this CLI, you can write a client, and then this gives you something like, hey, for this particular name, like get, you can actually run a function. So let me just open a different tool I have. So okay, and then I have admin. It's visible, right? Okay, and then actions. Just give me a second. So these are some of actions which I want to do in my application. So this is a different code, but we'll just look at it. This is some commands which you want to run. Like this client, I wrote it for like adding a SSH key into VMs and also some getting some VM instances. But this is some command which is going to run, right? So now let's see where it's being registered so that we can see. So new client. Okay, so it's been a while I looked at the code, so that's why I'm searching for the thing. But let me see whether I can find the reference here. So yeah, the point is, let's say, hey, you want to run something called Boom. Like you will have a Go, like your application .slash app or CMD, and then you say Boom, and then you say what you want to execute inside it. And then this will execute it. This is like a, you want to run some piece of code with the command line. So we can just quickly try this also in some place. Oh, let me just create some commands and then log.md. So we'll just okay, so now let's say this is hello. We want to run some command called hello. So we'll just say hello first. And then we'll just run this app. So let's just see whether this works fine. So yeah. Now if I do, let's say I do go build. Let me just do a go build. And then I do a commands. So now if you see the default, the library itself gives you all the benefit of, hey, what is this going to do? You can add a description and then you can do a lot of things like that. So now your like simple code is become a command line application. So you can keep adding stuff. So which is like, so now I want to add, let's say CLI app name usage action. So I think this is just a major function, but let's add subcommands, right? So this is subcommands. Let's look at commands. Yeah, so this is a app, but within that you have an action, and then here you'll find multiple commands and actions. I'm just trying to find that. Okay, yeah, so here you go. So this is some commands, multiple commands. So you can give, like you saw go test, that is just one thing, but instead of go test you have go wet, and then you have go lint and multiple things. But again, wet can take multiple, like different stuff also. So you can nest the commands and then you can finally pass in flags also. So first you will build this basic CLI app, like that is the first part, and then you do your major business logic with it or your command line application, what it's supposed to do. The second part is now, like if it is a backend service, then it's something to do with loading configurations, right? Usually how you load configuration in, let's say a Rails service, is you put a YAML file and Rails itself gives you something. Or if it's Java, you put, I think some ACT something, I forgot the name. There is some library which loads from properties files, or you can write code and then write by yourself. But in Golang, we majorly use two things. So let me just start it here. So we use majorly something called Viper. Viper is really standardized, but I personally prefer env config. I'll just show you why I like that. So let's just say I want to load some lot of configuration. This application has a lot of configurations, but this is two environment variables, okay? So this is a environment, like whether it is a production or a development environment, and how long should I run this particular command line application, you know, because you want to run it and then close it for after some time. So given this two, like the code has become a little generic and like complex, but you can say, hey, all I have to do is env config.process, and then I can actually give a prefix, and then I load the struct. You put the struct, then it will give you the config nicely. What I mean by that is, let's say we have a loader test, like ignore the loader test. So now if you have some config like this, producer hyphen something, you have Kafka brokers, how will it map to is, there is a producer, and then I have a Kafka brokers inside it. So all you have to do is, hey, say, split the words so that it is considering Kafka underscore, and then you can even nest it, and then you can keep adding a lot of values. So now let's just open some sample env, how this looks like, right? So this is my application. I have a config. The parent config I call, prefixed it with app. So it's like become app environment and app duration. And now I have, let's say, consumer. So the consumer have topic and enabled and something like that. So this becomes consumer underscore enabled, consumer underscore group ID and stuff like that. But all I have to do is like give a separate tag saying, hey, this is my default value. And this is my like expectation is producer underscore or consumer underscore concurrency and stuff like that. This is an exception because I don't want it to have a consumer topic and producer topic separately. For me, both producer and consumer is a single topic. So it just gives you a nice way to override it. And I didn't write any code. Like all I had to do was a loader dot load, give a prefix and this struct, and then it loads from env variables. So I can even show you in this. This will be much simpler one. So I have a user file, DB file, SSH key file and log level, and then your like here I'm using a JSON to use this, but this is much simpler one to like load, right? So let's see here. So I'm actually decoding into app config here, but it's like very similar. Or here, even though it's a JSON without env config file, the concept remains similar. So either you can use a JSON file and then load it by yourself, or a YAML file and then you can use it. Or if you're using env config, now you can actually choose to read it from env variables. And there is also a third thing, which is actually called flags. Golang flags. You would have seen go test --file or you know, --, some timestamp, whatever you give in the information, it's actually flags. So what you have is like flag dot something. You give it a name, and then this is a default value, and this is what the description of the flag. So now you actually have a three option. One is to load from env variables. Second is to load from a JSON or YAML file. Third is to load from flags, like user flag. So now how would you pick it, right? That is something I think depends on the application or ecosystem. But generally, how I would prefer is, in our ecosystem, mostly we use env variables. So all of the backend services we use, we know, hey, we use environment variables, because our deployment tools also expect something similar. But the second thing is, if you use flags, the best part is if you run PS AUX or if you inspect the process, right, you can see the whole flags, what it is doing. Because if you are using 100 of ENV variables, you don't know which variables you are missing, or it's hard to debug. But personally, if you use flags, it becomes much easier to debug. So what I'm trying to say is, so we have Chrome running, but these are the flags it's using. So I know whether this feature is enabled or whether something is missing. But if it's using ENV variable, all it's going to do is, let's say, this is some application that's running, but it might be using a lot of ENV variables, but we don't know what all it is. So it becomes harder to debug if you don't have a context. So you can look at ENV config or Viper, and then you load the values which you need for application. So Viper also gives you something similar, but rather it is more verbose. You have to say, hey, set default value for this, and then read value is something like this. Reads a string. Yeah, so you have to get a string and then assign it manually to some particular struct. If I have this particular struct, let's say config. Now how this will become is, I have to create a new consumer, and then I have to call enabled, and then I have to call get string, and then app consumer enabled, something like this. You have to read it manually, and also you have to parse it and then figure out, is there any errors or not and stuff like that. This is just more verbose. So personally, I prefer ENV config. So now I think that's first two parts, right? One is, okay, you use some CLI client, you define your list of things to do, and then you assign some actions to it. That is your command line application first job. Second is you load the configuration which you want to customize, because even for a particular one option, you can have multiple flags and then tweak whatever you want to do. So this is just two part. Like if you have more questions or like if you want to see more code, I can show examples, like different examples also. So let's see. So here I have like a gcloud client. That is the actual binary. Instances is the basic actions which I have. But then within that I have a search, or I can have multiple SSH access and stuff like that. And for search, I can have multiple things like, hey, use this DB file, this is the host mapping and stuff like that. I can also pass multiple other flags. So there is multiple level of, like, one is your binary. Second is you have list of actions, but within an action you have multiple flags. So there are three levels at least, which is happening to define your whole command line application. And this I think you can see in any command line tools which you are using. So that's it. That's on that. So like slightly I'll twist and then go to concurrency. Probably I think most of you would have heard Golang is well known for its concurrency or its performance or the way people write Go code or like threads or like lightweight threads, Go routines it's called. Like have anyone tried, like somebody new, can somebody pitch in like why this is better than, let's say, Java threads? Like anybody have read or something? Okay, sorry, go on. Okay, sure. So another question, right? So now I have a 12 core machine. This is actually 12 cores. Even though it's not 12, like it's hypervisor, you can run two things at a time, but let's imagine for simplicity, it's 12 cores. And with 12 cores, you can run 12 threads, something like that. Now, if it's Java, when you say, hey, thread, a thread will be assigned to a particular core, like core is actually a CPU, and you will run some job. Imagine there is 11 threads running some factorial of some number, and there is a last thread which is collecting all of it and then listing it. So in reality, in other applications, when you say heavyweight or not like lightweight threads, but rather when they call it threads, it's literally a thread running on the core itself. And a thread has a lot of, not complications, but context associated with it. One example is, okay, the moment I have a thread, what happens when there is two threads? I have only one code to do. So there is something called context switching happens. You take thread one, you put in thread two whenever you it's possible. What I mean by that is, let's take a use case. So we have thread one. This is, let's say, getting user details. Like get user details, and then we have a thread two. This is taking a name, let's say. This is actually calling a database. So name two, if we have. But let's say we have only one core, it doesn't necessarily have to like execute thread one and then execute thread two. Rather, what it can do is, okay, when thread executes, it makes a get user call, but internally it translates to, let's say, select star from users where x like name is equal to some blah. This is actually something called IO operation, right? In reality, your core is there, but in database might be some other place. You're making a call. It might take some time. So what it can do, the OS is, hey, I have this thread one, which is in some state X, and this is its state. It's waiting for some information, right? Then it can actually assign thread two to the core. So how it looks like is core thread one runs, and then core thread two runs. And then finally, this also makes a call, get user. And then here you can have thread one running back again. And then finally run thread two and then finish it. So this is called context switching. But obviously, when you switch something, what happens to the memory which you are accessing? What happens to the, like if you have five machine operations, where did you stop? Like you have to resume it back. So all that information is called context, like there is more to it, but it stores it and then resumes it back. To bring it even more layman terms, right? Now let's say you have an ATM, five ATM machines. Each and every person is going and doing a withdrawal. Each of us you can consider as a thread. The machine is called core, very simple terms. So you go debit money and then you're out. And then there is some other person coming and doing a debit money and then you're out. So this is equal to a thread. But now how Golang it differs is, even though I have a 12 core, in reality Java, you are limited to number of cores you have. I mean, in reality, at any point of time, you can only have a 12 threads running at this place. But in Golang, you can run, people say, hey, you can spawn millions of threads. You would have seen blogs and stuff. How it differs is, in reality, the thread is not thread. It's called something goroutines. Let's stick to that term. There is some thread which is running on the core, but rather it is scheduling the goroutines. Like it's doing the job of, hey, now I can assign you, do the operations and then leave you. Like let's start with layman terms first. So now instead of ATM, now imagine the ticket vending machine, like when you like go to a railway station or something. There is operators sitting in the vending machine, but each one of us go and ask him for the ticket. But now let's say he is asking for something, but he doesn't know where he wants to go or he doesn't know which train to pick. He actually says, hey, you sit, wait back. I'll give the ticket to somebody else and then you come again later, right? So in reality, even though there is four vending machine, we are like a lot of people going in and then doing the jobs at a particular point of time. So that is called lightweight threads. Like in reality, there is a thread, but you have a much smaller lightweight thread, go routine or go scheduler. It has a lot of nice features you guys can read. In a core, there is one thread which is dealing with multiple core routines and scheduling and stuff like that. So that is why people say, hey, now instead of dumping so many information, thread is like machine operations or so many things, go routines have to deal with only less operation, less data, metadata, something like that. So, okay, that is just a nice feature. Okay, I understand. Now what's with the code, right? Let's see. So let's just go to some, go routines. I have something called channels. I mean, we'll come to channels later. So let's just go to some other plain file. So now I'm doing start. So let's say I want to do some for. Yeah. So I'm just printing this 10 numbers. Number. Right. So simple law. But now let's say I also want to print from 100 to 200. Right. So we'll do something similar, but we'll call it bigger number. But in reality, let's just run this for now without any concurrency. And let's just say end, right? So this is simple, right? Straightforward. You're printing 1 to 10, 0 to 10 actually, and then here 100 to 200. So let's just go here. So go run, cars, go. This is fine, right? So this is sequential. What you see is very sequential. So you have 1 to 10 and also 100 to number. But now let's say you want to interleave or combine these two operations. I'm just going to change this to 50 and then run this. So all I have to do is call something called go func. Go, add go to below before it. If it was a function, the operation would have been much simpler. Let me just change that. Okay. So now I can say hey, func print 100 to 200, something like that. Right. So now all I have to say is print 100 to 200. That's it. So now let's see what happens. I'll just add time.sleep here. Like we'll come to this later. But now if I run this, so I'm just gonna add time. But now let's look at the top. It's like now it was running 100, 101, but also in the middle, it's running 0 to 10. Then it's running hundreds. This is still not completely interleaved, but you get a sense, right? Now it's a mix of operations. But all I had to do was do some, add some go in front of it, and then this is done, sort of done, right? So let's do one more thing. So I'm just adding time sleep. I'll come to this later. We can ignore this. So now let's go here. If you see, you know what's happening, right? I'm printing some number. Okay, big number is being printed. And then there is number. Big number is being printed. The ops or code I had to do was very simple. It's called go. And whatever your function was supposed to do, this you can literally map it to making an external HTTP call or making a DB call or doing something. But in reality, rather than waiting for 5 seconds and then 10 seconds, all you have to do is wait for the maximum time taken by some go routine, something like that. So this, in reality, I can actually run, I can even run multiple things. So, and this will just work fine. This doesn't have any limit, and then this will keep increasing. So even if I run this, it's going to work fine. There is multiple threads. If we had a go routine printed, then it would have been fine. So let's just say ID and this, let's say. I missed the printer. So yeah, now if you notice, I think we are seeing a bigger number. Let's just add a new line, sorry. Yeah. So now if you notice, there is a lot of different go routines, or this is actually like a multiple go routines, but all of them is doing the same job. But all I had to do was add another loop and do this. Now if you can extrapolate it and you can do you have go routines dealing with HTTP requests, but you have a go routine pool, all that stuff you can do very easily. I think this is quite a lot, but if you have any questions, I can clarify instead of going further. Any questions?
How do we implement
waiting for
everything. Okay, good point. Before that, any simpler questions? Like, I'll come to that.
So I saw that you have to follow.
Right. Some 100 to 200. Yeah.
So you are using it in the other in the main function.
This one, you mean? Go on.
So when you were running both the operations at the same time, the first group was coming into the second.
Yeah. So I mean, forget about this. This translated to, like, let's say you are computing a factorial of a big number. So yes, I mean, this is running continuously, but this is spinning go routines. But before that, there is already some parallel go thread or go routine which is running till printing till 50. Now you say, hey, I ask 10 people one by one to go collect 100 items. This is what is happening here. So I'm saying first person go get 100 to 200, second person go get 100 to 200, but all of them is doing the same job in reality at the same time. That's it. This is just an orchestration main you can think of. Okay, I'll come to your question, right? So now let's simplify it. The problem is not that. I removed that. Like, you know, now there is a lot of go routines you can run. So now I'm running the same application again. Obviously, I have to say only one, like this is the first ID. Okay, now I did run the function, right? So I have same code, literally same code. I'm doing start, I'm doing end, but in a go routine, I'm running 50, I'm running another 100 to 200 element. But when I run it, you don't see the numbers. Anybody guesses? Yes, sorry, one person louder. Like, anyway, what did you say?
The main loop terminates even before the go routine.
Correct. Like, so to explain, right? Your main is the actual process, or let's say here it's again a go routine main itself. You're running it, but let's imagine all three go routines going into a room and I can talk to only one person, let's say Anish Mishra. But the moment she comes out, even though other people did a lot of things, if she doesn't know what they're done, you would never know because you can only talk to her. So this is exactly what's happening here. The main is a go routine here. This is one. This is another go routine. This is another go routine. So literally it's like main go routine, which is running. And then here you have M1 and then go routine one. And then here you have M1 go routine one. And then you have go routine two also. But this M1 exists. And then after this, even though go routine one and two can run, in reality, your terminal doesn't see anything because the process is exited. So that is why I had to explicitly add a time.sleep. It's a hack, like it's not a perfect solution. So then what happens is it waits for that much time. So you see the result. So in I can actually reduce this instead of, let's say, 1000 ms, 1 second. If I reduce it, rather than seeing all results, you will see some result. Let's reduce it even further, or I'll increase the sleep, right? So it's running faster. So let's say 2 seconds, 2 milliseconds, second worst. Okay, I'm just gonna add, it's this have to be time dot millisecond. So now I'm sort of imitating, okay, the other guy is actually doing a job, but it's still slower. I mean, here it's doing showing exact numbers, but imagine if you have a random numbers. It's like you're doing a wait and then closing, but in reality, this is not the perfect solution, right? So now instead of three, two, I wait for one and you would see even less numbers. I can't build that. I have a lot of main applications here, but you get it right. Now how can somebody tell, hey, how much time can you sleep so that you see all the number? Is it possible to see? Because in reality here we are putting a sleep. But you don't have any measure on how much time a go routine can run. If it's a very simplistic application, I can say, hey, wait for 1 second, and in that time, I expect all of this to come. But this is not the best solution because it's obviously wrong. This is waiting a long time. what Golang gives you is there is two ways to synchronize. It's called synchronization. One is called channels. Like I'll leave channels now. Like that's channels is also a nice topic. But let's say there is something called weight groups. What it is I know 10 people are there and I have some other like metadata and I'm saying, hey, there is two people doing the job. Unless somebody comes and says, I'm done, you're not gonna go away. So, I mean, leave the syntax, but let's just try to write it. So I have something called sync.weightgroup. I'm just initializing this. So how many go routines we have here?
Two.
Okay, now I'm gonna say add two go routines. I have two go routines which is running. So now I'm gonna say wg.wait. That's it. So I will remove the sleep. So here I'm gonna say waiting, right, finish. Now let's get more interesting. Rand.inten, I guess. Some let's say 100. This is gonna give me a random integer. That's it. And I'm gonna convert it to some time.millisecond. And then let's say, yeah. And then I'm gonna wait for this much duration. That's it. So now instead of waiting for a specific number, I'm gonna wait for a random duration. That's all I'm trying to do here, ignore that. So now let's run this, right? Sorry? Yeah, yes, I forgot, yes. So here I'm gonna say wg.done, but I'll do a defer, like we'll come to that later, or like let's start simple. wg.done, once this is done, I'm gonna finish this coroutine. And then once this is done, I'm gonna finish this go routine. We have to add like synchronize. Okay, I shouldn't do this. Global variables is bad. So I'll just pass this WG. Right. Like ignore the nuances. But what I'm literally doing is I have a go routine and there is some like sort of metadata which we all share. And then the moment you are completed, you say you're done. And this guy is actually waiting for that to happen. So now let's run this. Okay, I have to do, it's okay, ignore that. So now if you see, this is taking random time, as you can see literally. But once this is done, then only the main go routine will stop. Literally, we don't have any measure on how much time this can take. But you see what's happening, right? I'm just waiting, literally. So if we reduce the time, it should be even faster. But till the time, makes sense, right? I have one go routine. Once it's done, it's saying done. The other go routine, once it's done, it's saying done. And then this wait literally is waiting for it to happen. You can almost imagine if you have n, this is almost like a semaphore. Until it becomes zero, this is gonna wait, something like that. So now if you notice, the moment the two go routines are completed, the main go routine ends. So we can add more func, which is like go func, func.println, I'm here, for loop, let's say some for loop, not for loop, let's say, let's just copy this. Yeah, so now there is another go routine, which is just doing the same job. But now to sync it, what do we have to do?
Add 3 and wg.done.
Perfect, yes. So all I have to do is 3 and then I have wg.done and I'm done. So this is gonna print it, let's say just 10 times. Here I'm gonna reduce the time.millisecond wait so that it gets faster done, right? Make sense. So now go run gars, something da, 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 da. And then this is done, all are done. So now let's see number, I'm here is also there, but it's completed faster, right? Cool. So this is synchronizing, like as in synchronizing, there is something called channels, which is even more cooler. Like as in, I can give a high level context, which is like, in general, Java, how do you share some data between threads? How do you share? Like I have, sorry? Go on, say it, it's fine, even if it's wrong, it's okay. Try.
It's like in Java, it communicates to sharing.
Perfect, perfect. But the problem is, now you have some, let's say, everybody is computing some number, but all of them want to sum some, like I want to sum 1 to 100, she have to sum to 100 to 200, and he have to do 300 to 400. If all of them are accessing global memory, what is the problem there? Correct. I mean, contention is a different thing, but the moment all of the multiple threads accessing the shared memory, it race condition. Yes. Perfect. Perfect. So in reality, if you want consistent data, you have to log the variable because let's say if all of our us are incrementing, one of our values could be like missed. The perfect classical thing which people talk with respect to logs is there is credit debit happening. For your same account, you're actually crediting at the same time, but you're also trying to debit an amount which is like not even existing in account. You have 200 rupees now, but somebody is crediting 500, but you're trying to debit 600. At the same time, what happens? If you want consistent data, you need logs. But the moment you add logs, now the problem is everybody have to wait for the logs. Exactly. That is a big flaw, or not flaw, but that's how all the other languages or threads have been operated. But now let's do some, like, I mean, since we already talked about it, we'll just add here. So I'll get rid of this stuff. Wait, I'm here. So I'll get rid of, I'll not get rid of this. This is fine. So now, like, tell me some ops. Like, we'll just, now the objective is not to wait, but rather, let's say, I'm computing some, let's say, right? What I can do is, okay, I think I have a sample. This is channels. All I have to do is create something called channel. The channel is shared across Go routines. It can be shared and you don't need to do logs at all. And of course, internally it's synchronized, but we don't have to do that. It's a nice feature. And here I'm saying I have in for loop, I'm putting some talks and then there is some other Go routine, which is the receiving talks. In fact, which let's go further. I have another Go routine. This is again doing the same thing. The way you write data inside is like this. That's it. Dot. So like this, and then let's just simplify it to 10. And then here you have 5. So I have 5 docs, which is being printed. I just have to call it. So here, if you notice, I have one Go routine, like we'll come to this Go routine later. I have a Go routine, which is actually saying, this is top 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And then I have another Go routine, which is printing 10 random stuff. And this is another Go routine, which is consuming the talks, and then it's just going to print it. So we have 3 things. One guy is saying, I have 5 talks with number index. There is a second Go routine, which is going to say 10 random stuff into the talks. There is a third person who's going to say, receiving the talk and then printing it to the audience, let's say. So now let's just run it. Like, this makes sense, right? The code makes sense. Or do I have to go through again? You know the Go syntax. This is for loop. Instead of printing, you are adding it here. This is called putting into a channel or pushing into a channel. This is actually reading from channel, but ignore it. The its equivalent is you have to have an arrow. Yeah.
In line reading, when you say make, then provide the 10.
Yeah.
10 is the allocation.
I'll come to that later. I'll come to that later. So now let's just run it, right? So I have go run chance.go. Obviously same problem as you guys know. So I'll just do time.sleep for now. Sorry? This? Yeah. I mean, range consumer is not yet called. Like I'll come, okay, fine. I think I created this for something else, but I'm just going to call range consumer. There you go. Range consumer is called. Range is just reading. It's a different way of reading. Like the nuances we can ignore for now. There is a problem. We'll come to that. Here you see consumer received a talk, panic sent the channel. What happened? I think it's closed the channel before even completing, but it's fine. I have to just do this and then it should be fine. So now you see, I had a, like I've received four things. I've received 10 random stuff and you were done. All I had to do was use this channel and you're done. You don't have to do any sync operation and stuff like that. This you can extrapolate and do like one channel, there can be 100 consumers. Literally like, what good example I can give? There is a lot of head requests coming in. You can put the request into a channel. There can be 30 workers, like literally it's called workers, and then those workers can share a channel and then do the work. So that is the best example. Usually in prod code, we do that. I mean, now I'll give you all the context, like quickly I'll show the last copy, that library we wrote, how we used it. So that'll make sense. But this makes sense, right? Like channels, concurrency, go routines is much more simpler, very easy to do. If you're not aware, you guys should go look at Rob Pike's talk. Concurrency is not parallelism. And like, this is really good talk. You guys should watch. There is also something else called, I forgot the name, CSP by Hoare. Like if somebody wants to write, read papers and stuff, this is called communicating between sequential processes. Rather than communicating in a shared memory way, long back, they've created this channels and approaches. The Golang implemented this based on this paper. This is by Hoare. I think there are algorithms he created, like full algorithms, I forgot the names. So he's a computer scientist. So this makes sense, right? We'll move to the next step. Any more questions here? Like you understand, yeah.
So in this channel, like, right now we have done a time box leak, right? So
yes.
Like the main channel doesn't get closed.
Yes.
So there was just one consumer
and multiple producers, kind of like you have 30 workers on the channel. Then we could have actually
looked for that many number of messages in the
channel. Then okay. So the consumer, what it does is the consumer reads till the channel is closed. This is nuances like others you guys should read. If the channel is closed, you can't push a data. Like the error you saw was I did a sleep later. But I was pushing data, like obviously you can't push to something which is closed. So now this consumer sorted. These people are just producing. So for producers, you don't need to worry. The usual convention is one producer creates a channel. The moment you finish producing, you close the channel. Like that's how it works. And there are multiple ways to read it. But I think I'll not go into that. Like that's a different topic. Like select case, all that stuff is a like read for you. Separately. So I think that's we covered, like we have a concurrency. Now you know, right? Like your application have to do something. You want to do 5 jobs, now you can do parallelize it. You can take any example, but let's take something simpler. Let's say I have git push -fn tags. Let's say I have a lot of tags here we go. Git tag -fn list. One use case I can think of straight is rather than pushing one tag at a time, I can push all the tags in a concurrent go routines. So your push is faster. Your operation of git push tags becomes quick compared to the sequential pushes. That's the example. So now let's go to the metrics. How many of you like track metrics and have alerts on your services based on metrics? Okay, 1, 2. Okay, 3, 4. Other people still write backend services, right? So let's say now the question is, you're doing orders, bookings, but suddenly like Uber, you're not making any bookings at one point of time. How would you know? Like for others who didn't raise hands. Anybody? You can say, or you would be debugging, right? Okay, your application is dead, but how do you know how it's dead, why it's dead? You're writing Go, right? You can pigeon. How do you track that? How do you know what happened?
Okay.
Yeah,
go
on. Okay, you have metrics. What about you?
We don't like it, so we are
not. Okay, sure. So, I mean, metrics, when we talk about it, there is multiple subsections to it. One is system metrics. The second is business metrics. System metrics is, let's say I have HTOP, like treat my machine as actually a server. And any point of time, if there is any anomaly in system metrics, I have to have alerts. But in this page itself, what is the system metrics you guys can look? Yeah, you can be louder. Memory, one memory.
Number of tasks.
Number of tasks, sure. Others, yeah. CPU size, perfect. And then, sorry? Yeah, memory again. Memory, CPU usage, number of tasks, yes. This is literally like what you're looking at. So load average is like the CPU load time over a period of time. So the moment I, let's load the application, right? Let's do that. I have too many things. So let's just load, go. What I'm gonna do is, any way you guys can think of loading an application, like loading your system? Perfect. So I have, let's say some 1,000 go routines. In reality, this won't work. Like nuances will leave that, but let's just say it's gonna do forever loop, nothing else. I'm gonna spin up 1,000 go routines. It's all gonna run forever. Let's just try to run it, right? So let's go here. I've had stop here. I'll go here. Go routines, I guess. Go run load. Sorry. Yeah. I'll do. I'll just do time dot sleep. Some. I'll wait for 10 seconds. Now let's go look here. You can already see the CPU is getting full. So now this is an anomaly. Like in reality, you would have a lot of code and we can watch the load average will keep going, growing. In reality, if you don't monitor your application, at some point of time, like there is a hacker or some attacker who is pushing so many requests, or there is some code which got deployed, which is a bad code, and then your system is happening. So you can see the memory is also trying, like over slowly will grow. Also memory leaks, like I think definitely you all would have heard of. So this is a system metric and then you have to watch over it. And then you will have alerts because anytime if your CPU goes beyond 90% or let's say even the like load average goes beyond number of cores, you can't run more process. So what you have to do is have a metric on that and then alert whenever you reach beyond a threshold. So that is system metrics. Now the second ops is, So now I should be fine. Yeah, I'm fine. So now the second ops is, let's say our business functionality is, we were talking about Kafka. We wanted to push X messages and we wanted to receive X messages. So the number of messages is a metric, but also the other metric we are interested in is latency. If you're thinking of Uber, some application, number of customers, number of drivers, number of signups, number of OTPs sent, all of this is a business metric. Like, I mean, obviously it's not going to be single service, but that particular microservice, the business logic is that. So the metrics is that, and usually we use Prometheus or Statsy. Like have anyone used Statsy? I think Statsy is the like whole thing. What do you guys, yeah. So Statsy is very simple UDP thing. All you have to do is do statsy.send and you are done. The other one is Prometheus, which is like got like adopted really famous these days. But I think I can show Prometheus. I don't have Statsy example like right now, right away. So let's just go to producer, have a producer. And then I have, don't worry about the code, bother about. I think I have it in callbacks. So, but I have something called metrics.prometheus.go. And I was talking about, right? Like I have a lot of metrics, which is number of messages sent, number of messages received. What is the latency? These are all the metrics I'm tracking. And this is the percentiles also. Like that's leave that for later. And then number of consumers running, number of producers running, all that stuff. So now, like if I open some dashboard, so ignore this. Don't look at the text. Yeah, so this is some latency graph. Like there is a lot of data in it. So let's just say, what can I open? GraphQA consumers running, let's just say. So I have a lot of consumers which is running. You see the data, right? I can track it and then say, hey, whenever there's an anomaly here, I'll just increase it so that you don't see it. So whenever there's an anomaly, I can raise an alert. Usually you can see my 99 percentile is less than 500 MS. Like this is for different clusters. Like I'll come to the context of how we created this dashboard. But whenever you cross 1 second, let's say now you breached your threshold. So now you should have alerts. This is your business metrics, but also system metrics, you will have something similar. 90% reach or 70% memory reach, then you should have alerts. Then we go and see what happens, something like that. So this is that part. But I mean, like you guys can go check the code. It's as simple as like creating a consumer here. Like in Prometheus, it's much more than other places, but you can say, hey, something like, this is the labels and then observer value. This is the processing time, like something like that. So what I'm trying to say is metrics is important and then you need to alert based on it, because if you're running some business 24/7, you have to support, then this is important. That's it. You can look at Statsy and Prometheus, which is well known. It also gives other things like TickStack or Inflex, Grafana. What I showed you is Grafana, all that stuff. Open tracing is like Neuralink. I think people would have used Neuralink, anybody? Okay, one person. So now I'll ask you a different question, which is, let's say, let's go to this code. Let's go to this code where we had channels. So now we have talks, but let's say this is doing some operation, right? But how would you know whether this goroutine is taking time or this goroutine is taking time? Or do you even know how much time it takes? Like right now we don't know, right? So ideally what we should, like anybody quick thought on like, how do you measure this time taken by range consumer? Let's say I have a function, I have a goroutine. How would you measure the time taken by this function? Profiling is different, but very simple, like encode. Yes. So I have I'll have to add a start time, start here, which is actually, let's say time.now. And then here you will have end, which is time.now minus start, which is actually latency or time taken. This is what it's called. Like you measure the time taken by your particular goroutine or function. Neuralink, all that, there are lot of tools available, open tracing, all this stuff. What it does is you can keep doing this and you would know what, like which function takes how much time. So we'll just go back to the same thing, producer. So I have something called, I have span. So I have very similar thing. I'm actually producing a lot of messages and I'm trying to see how much time it took for a produce. That's it. So this is that measurement. So you have to measure system metrics. You have to measure business metrics. You also have to measure how much time your function took. Like ideally you would benchmark and then do a lot of optimization if that is interesting. But yeah, this is the case. So now, yeah, that's part of metrics. Logging, like I think well known, you have to use JSON. Because of so many things, you can have some other consumers listening to the JSON metric and then have a dashboard on number of 5xx, number of 4xx. And also latency, you can print it here. The whole HTTP call, how much time it took, all this stuff. If somebody's saying, no, I shouldn't do that, it's okay, you can say it. Or if there is any questions, let me know. Any questions till now? Metrics and logging is simple, right? I think this is too much interfaces for now. So I think I'll just show one thing. Creates messages and publishes Kafka to Kafka, yeah.
And so this should be running on both the sides, right?
Exactly, precisely, yes. I'll actually run it and then show you. I think we have some time, so it's good. I'll just cover interfaces, like, but since there's a lot of new folks. Can somebody tell me what interfaces, anybody, Java, anything? Of course you use Java and interfaces, I know. It's okay, you try. You should do it. It's okay, you can say it. Oh, you have never worked with Java and other languages? Okay, lucky guy. Anybody else like interfaces?
I think it's a bundle.
Correct. So, I mean, I'm sure you guys would have seen it. So you would have written something like interface, something like what class? Let's say a logger class, logger and then interface. You will have something like print. What do you expect the logger to do? You have debug, and then you have what? Let's say trace. This is the interface which you all would have seen. And in reality, you would be creating some logger of this type. But you can have, let's say, JSON logger. You can have file logger. You can even have, let's say, socket logger. You get what I'm trying to say is right? So this print, it's going to print the same content, but in JSON format. But let's say this is to stdout, right? But this guy can actually do the same thing, but print the content in a file. But all of them have a contract, same contract, because they all implement an interface. So it becomes something like this, implements logger. I'm sure you guys would have seen, right? Yes. So, but now you have interface and then you have a lot of classes implementing it. But Golang differs very, like it's so different, like do not even relate it to Java, I would say, learn it fresh. Let's just look at, let's say producer. So yeah. Okay, so I have something called some message creator, okay? And I have some method, and then this returns me a message. This is a actual message. Like it has sequence ID and data, like that's not a problem, we'll come to that. So I have new message with fake data, and then I have to return some message. Now the point is, anybody who have this contract satisfies it. All I have to do is inject it at the right time. So, let's write something, right? So I have, so I have this producer simple, and then we'll just write package producer. I think I should write it as a test so I can run it, but I think it's going to be, okay, I'll start fresh, even simpler. There is something called interfaces. Let's see what happens there. This is big, but it's okay. So we'll start fresh. So I'm going to get rid of this. So I'm going to say, hey, give me, I have interface. And then I have, this is called, let's say, data provider, let's say. And then I have something called data. And I return some string, let's say. Fine. And all I have to do is, let's say, have a data provider, DP, and then now I have to have a some data provider, right? So let's say number provider. Let's say we have something called number provider, right? So, and then db.data, if I call it, it should print. Okay, so interface, I think I missed some very basic syntax. This is like, sorry? Fine. So now if I print this, I don't have anything. So let's just implement this struct number provider type. Forget about this. Like I'm just creating a function. Don't bother about the like syntax for now. But I'm saying, hey, return, I'm giving data, right? Something like this. And if I run this, say go play, I had it in interfaces. I'm giving data, makes sense, right? All I did is creating a interface and then this struct has it. But in reality, I'm using the real struct. Now let's do this, var DP. So I have something called data provider. Okay, now I can say, hey, new provider. Let's just call this new provider. Func new provider, this guy is gonna give me an interface. Like this is not like idiomatic Go, I'm just writing some code for like you to see. So I'm gonna say number provider, that's it. But now, let's say instead of this, I'm also adding something called, like the cool thing is I have something like type blah string, and then I can even have function on top of this, which is blah. And then I can give data. And then let's say I can say return B. I think this should work. Let's see. This should return a string. I'm implementing something on the actual type itself. But instead of returning number provider, I'm going to return blah. And then I'm going to call it, let's say, some x. And then x is var, x is blah. This is cool. Let's say something like this. So I'm actually returning a string, but I have a data on top of it. And then I have the data being printed. I hope this works. This is like nuance. Okay, minus syntaxes. So 11 no new variables, cannot use B in return argument. Sure. So it's fine. I'll change this. I'll just change this to struct. I'll just change this to, let's say, string. I have name, and then I have b.name. And then when I'm creating it, I'm gonna create a blah, but it's called name. So now I'll return this, something like this. So now let's see, 11, DP, this was an error, and I'm done. So yeah, so now, like there's a lot going on here, but as you can see, now I have a number provider struct, but I have a blah struct. Both of them are having the data thing. And then all I had to do was like use that and then print the data. But nobody is telling me that, hey, I have implemented this particular interface. All you have to do is you take anything, and if that guy satisfies, which is like if you have a function which you expect in the interface, then you are good to go. The cool part of this is like you can write tests without any external library. All I had to do is, now let's say if we want to write a test for this function, like people write, anybody write unit test here? Unit test? Okay, then there's a little too much. But let's say this is making a DB call. But if you're writing unit test, you wouldn't have database calls in reality. So what you have to do is generally mock this. But for us, instead of providing data provider, which is actually making DB call, you can actually create something very similar called dummy data provider and pass it into this main. Instead of calling this, I can say, hey, my function should inject this interface and you're good to go. You can actually test this. You can write your own custom code and you don't need any external libraries like Mockito or Assert or like other Java and Ruby makes it really complicated, I think. So this is like easy, straightforward code. And the interface like doesn't have any limits. So I'll just show you one code, which is like create bytes. Yeah, so let's say this is all interface. Anytime you go into Golang run code, you will see it's a decoder is an interface. Because in decoder, you can have JSON decoder, you can have byte decoder, you can have file decoder and stuff like that, right? You see, this is a parser which has encoder and decoder. You can nest interface and stuff like that. So this gets interesting over time. But yeah, this is just a, like, probably take it in a pinch. You guys can go read about it. So now I think this is good enough stuff. I don't know what else I added in the list. I'll just close everything. So I can just show some test, I guess, for this to sample. So let's say I have a consumer. The consumer uses some interface, but in reality, consumer test, we are actually creating some dummy struct. And then we are telling it what to give. We are using something called testify mock. This is really good. Like this is just a syntactic sugar, but you can literally hard code the values here and then you can still do this. So this is the same code you saw. The consumer is using some features, but here I'm mocking it in test. And then here, when I create a consumer, if you notice, I'll be injecting a mock. like here I'm creating a consumer, but I'm injecting this Kafka consumer, which is a mock, something like that. I think this is a lot. Like, we have covered enough. I'll leave all of this. I think this is too much. So let's just run the application so that you will get more context. And if you want, I can go into the code and then see what it is there. So I'm running, I'll run Kafka. No Zookeeper server to stop. Okay, I think it's already running. Kafka server. Run this Kafka server start. Okay, I have a Kafka running. Ignore this. Like, anybody still doesn't know what Kafka is? Like, PubSub model still need clarification? Okay, good. So now I have something called Kafka. I'm just gonna build it. So I'll edit. So I'm producing to localhost 9092. In reality, it could be some other server. I'm producing like 1,000 messages, okay? And leave the concurrency, all that stuff. So I'm producing to some topic called KafkaQA001, right? And I have a consumer which is doing some very similar thing. It's consuming from localhost. So let's just run this. I have to source this, kafka.env. We'll come up. So now if I see this, it's actually producing messages, and then there is also consumer which is running together. In reality, you can also separate it. Let's see what happens. It should be sending message and receiving message. The Kafka server wasn't up. That was a problem. So let me just stop this. So now if you notice, the report was no message was sent, no messages was received. That's a point. So I think now we are good to go. So let's do this again. So we are sending some dummy messages and we are receiving the same dummy messages. If you notice, we are using some ID. We are also using some sequence. We are putting some timestamp because we want to compute what is the time taken from send to receive. Because while sending, you set the timestamp. While receiving, you receive it and then see what is the time depth. That's a high level. But now this is done. I think now if I stop it, if you see, I have sent 1,000 messages, I've lost 400 messages, I've received 600 messages. This is the report, but what you saw in the other graph was actually a live graph, because earlier we thought this, we can just do it at once whenever people say there is an issue, but then we realized people have this issue very often and then it's not something we can do reactive, but rather we started actively sending data and then receiving data from all the clusters. And what you saw was some latency on all of our clusters. So whenever I see some anomaly in any of my clusters, I know there is something going on wrong. So we started measuring this with the same tool. I know it's a lot, but just to like anybody who is interested in to see, we use something called Confluent Kafka Go, which is actually well known for Kafka library. It's by I forgot his name. They are like, it's in Google everybody is using this. This is well known for it. They have libraries in Ruby and other languages as well. So this is some standard thing. So you can see this is producer, but you can see this is a go routine. I'm producing a lot of messages, right? Your application is doing a lot of things. And also here, I'm having concurrency. Like in reality, I want to achieve a lot of throughput, like not just 100 messages, but I want to send millions of messages also. So all of this is like worker, go routine. Like as I said, go routines are workers here. So here we are actually sending messages to Kafka. That's all this file is doing. Now let's go to consumer. So consumer is very similar, but in reality, if you have a lot of messages, You can't just run one instances. You have to run like hundreds of consumers and then run consume from the same channel. So that's what we have called parallelism. So ignore this, let's say concurrency. So for this much concurrency, I'm gonna actually create consumers. And then I think there'll be like, so this many consumers I'm creating, and for each and every consumer, I'll be running it. So for each and every consumer, I'll start running the processing. So let's just say, this is the processing which happens for each and every consumer, which is actually reading message. So this is literally reading a message, and then it's doing some ops, like ignore all of this. It's reading a message, and then it will measure all the latency and things, like which is done in callbacks. But here you'll have like hundreds of consumers, 10 producers producing to Kafka and measuring and pushing data at the same time. That's it. You can see I'm using goroutines, wait groups. I'm using channels for multiple things, synchronizing. When I receive something, all the goroutines should close, all that stuff. And also here, let's go to producers, right? Producer, whatever concept you saw before. So here in producer, I'm actually reading from message and pushing to Kafka. And there is somebody who's also pushing to that Kafka. So here, this is all reading. And then here actually pushing messages to Kafka, some other channel, something like that. So you have a channel, 100 people is pushing data and pumping into that. There is some people listening to this channel and then pushing to real Kafka or let's say database. There is consumer receiving from that Kafka and then pushing into some channel, and a lot of people are processing it, something like that. So the basic funda is like same, underlying is goroutines, channels, you synchronize with wait groups, and you have like loading configurations, and then you run it, capture metrics. This is available like in GitHub, so you guys can have a look at the code. I'll add the screenshot and stuff, but the code, if you want to have a look at it, it's available. So that's all from me. If unless you like, you can shoot me questions. Any questions? Shoot.
Just two questions on the life environment when we are doing this call. So you are generating some learning data, right? And like at a particular frequency.
Yeah.
And that is on a specific topic which your other consumers will not be subscribed.
Correct. Yes. This is the topic only we are interested in.
So do you also see a problem where like a cluster has a problem with like specific to different topics?
Yeah, we've extended it. It's like we've extended this to like dynamically consume your topic also, but we don't know what is the contract. So we ended up using like, I mean, not reflection, but there is some, we are using protobufs. We had to use a library to figure out, hey, this, just give me the timestamp field. I'm not interested about any of this other fields, but as a convention, all of the people which we use, we push timestamp into it. And then we just measure the timestamp. So in parser, we have written some like proto parser and stuff like that. And all I have to do is figure out timestamp. Like this is, ignore this. So I think there will be some proto. Yeah. So this is some test proto. I don't have to bother about this. All I have to bother about this event timestamp field. So I have, like we have extended this obviously. So this, I say, hey, this is it. This is the index. This is the proto, stuff like that. We sort of dynamically parse it and then do whatever you were saying. We're still doing it, but it's slowly evolving. That's it. Anybody else specific to concepts or code, or you still want more clarification, I can show. Okay. Yeah, so basically we have Kafka. Okay. So what we are trying to do is measure latency. And then we are trying to measure message loss, let's say, right? So you produce 1,000 messages. If you consume 1,000 messages, you're good. And also each and every message, you compute latency. How you compute latency, let's call it TP when you produce. And then when you receive, it's called TC. And the latency is actually TC minus TP. That's it, right? Simple. Now what happens is there is a lot of producers, producer 1, 2, 3, till 10. Which is producing to some topic, let's say test cluster topic, right? And there is a lot of consumer which is running, consumer 1, 2, 3, it could be till 1,000 or whatever, 10,000. Like it's a Kafka internal thing. all of them are consuming from test cluster topic. And we have a hash. That's how you can tell this particular message is consumed in the end. Like if you see a creator message, what we are producing is sequence. It's a, we put UUID also. This is some random data and then timestamp. This is a UUID. You can actually see, hey, if you're running in memory, both consumer and producer, you sent some, let's say UUID one, if you consumed UUID one, you take it off from your pending message or something like that. So that's how you generate a report. So now you run this forever. You're not bothered about data loss, but rather you're bothering about latencies, because latencies we keep capturing. And any point of time, if it goes beyond a threshold, which is your SLA or like your commitment to the user, you have alerts. So high level producer producing dummy data to Kafka, you consume. So you know Kafka is working fine. So there's just a tool around it. If you're running it locally, it's in memory. If you're running it in two different places, you can use a Redis obviously. Again, it's interface, so you can extend it. So exactly what you're saying, it have to be Redis. If you're distributed producer and consumer, you have to share some Redis or something and then do the same operations you were doing.
Can you assume that the GUID is unique across all?
Of course, GUID is unique. We use libraries, right? That UID is always unique. That's GUID.
And does it add to the overhead? Like,
no, not much. We are bothered about latency, right? The produce, even if you take 10 seconds, I'm bothered about when I'm sending the message. That is when I set the timestamp. So yeah. Any other questions? Like all of this is test, like tools. We are pushing it in Kubernetes. So we have Docker files also. If you want to run it, you can run it. We also have Helm chart for this. If you want to try it in Kubernetes. In Kubernetes, we scale it to a lot of producers and a lot of consumers easily. But yeah, going back, any basic questions, like any others, still if you feel something is missing, you can say, you can cover.
Yeah, I have not used Kafka, but in what cases can you get the message
off? Like, forget about it, but let's say if somebody's coming and telling, hey, I didn't receive this message, how do you even figure out? It's hard. Kafka doesn't, you don't have message loss, but in rare cases you can have message loss, but that's like a separate topic to discuss. Kafka is huge. So I'm assuming everybody got the whole context and flow. Any more questions? We can take it offline also. If not, I think I'm done.
So
thank you. Yeah.
We
use Syrups and Logrus, if you guys want to know, I think I didn't talk about dependency also, but let's say dependency management, we use GoMod. Earlier it was Dep and Glide. Now in Golang, GoMod is the convention or standard. We use Syrups, and this is the JSON logger we use. You can look at it. Testify is the library which we use to test. This is also really good. I personally started using Uber Logger. Syrupsen is part of it, but like it's in test and stuff. Uber has a better logger, like it's faster. I think it's called Zap. I think I didn't use it here, but in other library I used it. So yeah, this is another logger. Like I personally have some pet projects which I use this logger. This is faster. And Urfev CLI is the tool. Like this is not a command line application, but let's say I have some thing. So this is another library just using, it's a command line tool. This is a CLI I'm using BoltDB, but I want to show the other one. The env config is just env config. Like that's also nice, but you can have a refer. You can look at this in GitHub. It's available. So I can show the other thing which I've written. Like that's a simpler command line application. Like you can add your SSH key into your VMs. You can actually list all the instances with some prefix and stuff like that. Like I don't know what is the use case for you, but generally like we deal with multiple clusters and we have like thousands of VMs. Generally I want to know, hey, go into all Kafka boxes. So I sort of like written something like you SSH into all boxes and then you can do some ops like that. So this is a perfect, like simpler command line tool. You can also refer at this if you want to know. So that's KafQA, this is this. And you can look at communicating sequential process, ROP by talk, Viper and env config for loading configuration. What else? For anybody who is new, I would say code review colon, I guess. Code review comments. Effective Go, yeah. So you should read Effective Go. This is actually talking about a lot of conventions. The moment you, like, or even if you are writing prod ready systems, production ready systems, have a look at this. This has really good content about how you should do things and how you shouldn't do some stuff. More on convention and also on like wet issues and nuances. Like this is how you're supposed to use a lot of things like that. This is really good. Yeah, you can have a look at it. Yeah, any other questions? Like if you have, you can shoot. If not, I'm done. Thank you. Yes. Yes. Sorry, have been what?
I mean,
what's the CLI? Sure. Huh, yeah, Cobra is also a good thing. No, it's very similar. But I feel that's, again, more verbose. I like the CLI. Not performance reasons. Like, obviously, there are multiple alternatives. Loggers, you can bother about performance reasons. But I wouldn't bother much on the client. Our Go binary size is not big, right? It's not too huge. Sure. But the level we deal with is not like you're not running your application in a 250 MB embedded systems or something. So in that way, I'm saying we don't usually bother about binary. I haven't done benchmarks, so I don't know much. Oh, Zap, there is a lot of benchmarks which is done. Officially, I've seen. And also production, you can use multiple flags. There's no, like, it's really, I've seen it being really faster because usually in a prod, we disable logs, right, to have a better performance. So Zap, there is benchmarks, but I don't know whether there's benchmarking on CLI versus.
Yeah.
I don't know on that. Yeah. Anybody else? I think there was something on chat. I don't know. If not, I think it's okay. Okay. Thank you. Fine. Yeah, that's it. I'm done. Thank you. You can catch up later. There is coffee. I think there might be snacks also in the pantry. And feel free to catch up with. Thank you.